Today we're going to cover the map collection, which is another one that we need to learn. Basically, sometimes it has a couple of different names in different programming languages. We're just going to see what it is today. Basically, sometimes it's known as an associative array or a dictionary. These are the two commonly used names for a map as well. Basically, a map is a storing key value pairs. So it maps a key onto its value. So let's see how we can create a map and how we can use it. And then you'll immediately see why it's called associative array. I mean, dictionary might not be as apparent, but associative array, because it associates every value with something, you know. So let's see. I'll create a new file here. Let's say collections two. Doesn't really matter. Let's go main. And I'll just run this, so it's my next runnable configuration here. Okay, and now we will just create a map. Similar story to what we've covered last time, map is an interface. We are going to use one implementation of the interface. So if I start typing here, you can see map of A and V. This is a generic class, similar to a list, because of course, key can be anything, value can be anything. So we're creating a map of something and something else. So let's create a map of integer. What does that mean? That means our key is going to be integer, and we're going to be putting integers in there as the value. So let's name it map equals new. And now we know we cannot instantiate the interface. We need to choose some implementation of the map, like hash map or tree map. Again, as you can assume, hash map is just going to be the regular one. Tree map is going to be the sorted one, you know. So let's use the hash map. We need the regular one just to see what happens. So what can we do with a map? Well, we can put values inside of it. We can say put, and you can see, of course, when I type put, you can see here from IntelliJ knowing what to help us out, that we can put an integer key and an integer value. If it's a map of integer string, you can assume what's gonna happen. If I start typing put, now IntelliJ is like, oh, you need to put an integer key and a string value. So what does this mean? Well, let's put a key of one and then a value of Milan, for example. And I mean, this is a map. You put some key and you assign a value to it, and that's it. What happens if you try to put another key? It just puts that, and now we can fetch that value later using get. So we can do map get, and you just pass the key here. You pass the key, let's say one, and what's that gonna be? Well, of course, it's gonna be what you put in for that key. So let's print that out. So map.get one. And let's say map.get three to see what happens. Of course, if you try to get something which doesn't exist, it'll just return nothing or a null. And what will happen if you put two things with the same key? So let's say Nicola here. And of course, what's the value going to be here? Well, we put something with a key of one, and then we override it with something else with the key of one. So of course, only one value will be saved, the latest one. So if I run this, we expect to see here Nicola, and we expect to see nothing for or a null for you know, getting the key which doesn't exist. And this is the map. Why is it called an associative array? Well, because our arrays basically are maps that always map. So let's create an array, integer array or a string array, really. String array, let's call it array equals new string array. And let's make it a string array of two. So basically here, look, I'm mapping the index of the, I'm mapping literally the index of the array to some value. So imagine here, instead of me saying an index, I could say anything, really. I could map like a string to a string. I could say array of first is Milan, you know. In some languages, this is allowed. And that's why it's called associative array, because it associates some value with some key, you know. The key itself for arrays, it's always an index, you know, always 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. But in a more general case, a map basically can map anything to anything, right? It can be a person, it can be an array of people, but for keys, we don't necessarily have to use numbers, right? For array, we do, but for maps, we don't. For maps, we can map a string onto a string. We can map an integer we can map anything onto anything. And how do we actually use this? Well, now we'll see in a couple of examples how we can use this and why it's useful. This is a general idea, and I just wanted to draw this parallel with arrays. You know, array is always mapping an integer onto whatever it is, you know. So the first dimension here is always an integer. Imagine an array as a map of integer to something, you know, and that something is what your array is of. But basically, it cannot map any integer. It must be the index of that integer, right? Okay. So how can this already be useful in some of the one of the examples that we've already been implementing on this course? Let's come back to the problem of counting the number of letters. You guys remember when we were making that anagram algorithm, where we wanted to count all the letters in a word. We wanted to say it has 3 A's, 4 B's, 0 C's, and so on. You guys remember when we were doing that? We were doing something like array letter frequency equals new int array of 26. And at that point, I mentioned, you know, when a letter comes in, how do we know which index we put it at? Let's say letter, let's say char, oh my God, char letter equals, you know, letter at some, you know, just letter comes in. Let's say it's letter H. How do we know we found the letter H? How do we know which array index to increase here? Well, we said, oh, okay, the index int index, we had a trick here, basically. Int index equals letter minus A, and then we figure out, oh, okay, this is gonna be the index, let's say for letter H, this is gonna be like, I don't know, like 8. And we say now letter frequency of, you know, index plus plus. We found an H, increase H's position. But what happens when letters are not English alphabet? There's not 26 of them. They're also, let's say, Serbian. Let me just change here to Serbian to show you some random letters. And not even the comment is at the same bloody place. So let me just put the comment there. And now let me just do a couple of Serbian letters here for you guys. What do we do with these letters? Well, our indexes break down. I cannot simply say, what is this letter minus A? Well, I don't know the ASCII code for this letter, so let's see it, you know, S out. I'll just put the letter here, and let me just now change to back to English. Let's say this minus A, what will this produce? Let's run it. I mean, I don't even have an idea about this. So it's 172, wow. So now A letter starts somewhere. A, as we know, is like 95 or whatever. This means that my letter, which is called K, is basically 172 from letter A. So now what happens if we have some more letters? I don't have a Spanish keyboard here, but you all know the N with the tilde on top of it and so many other letters. So our program was merely designed to work with English letters because they're just so nice. They're all next to each other because, of course, when the people that created ASCII were making ASCII, they just put A, B, C, D, E, F, G all next to each other. But then K came somewhere later. K also, I mean, all the other letters that don't exist. And imagine all the letters from all the languages. So what do we do now? Well, maps come to our rescue here. We are not going to create an array anymore. We're going to create a map which maps every letter to its frequency, right? So that's the idea here. So let's do that. And I will on purpose put in our input some of these letters. Also, one more thing, it will work for any character now. We can use special characters. We can count the occurrence of any character now using a map, because a map doesn't care how many elements there will be. It doesn't have to specify this. We just find a new letter, we put it in the map if it doesn't exist. If it does exist, we increase the count by one. And that's the idea. So let's implement now a much more comprehensive and powerful way of counting letters in a string. Let's do that. I'll get rid of this because we don't need any of this. Of course, this was just the illustration to freshen your guys' memory on what we've been doing before. You know, we knew we had 26 letters. We had this neat way to calculate the index of each letter. This was just basically a workaround for beginners with don't know math. So let's do it the proper way. Let's now create a string input. Input equals new string. Okay, whatever. Let's just put a bunch of random letters in here. And I'll also add some more random ones that don't exist in English. Just to verify, I mean, we want to see ch appears one time, you know, we want to see that. We don't want this program to crash. There is even a number 3 in here somewhere. So yeah, let's now see what we can do with this. Let's say count letter occurrence or count letters, you know, count letters from input. And this is going to be basically returning a map. So yeah, it's going to be returning a map. So I'll say map of what? Let's deduce that together. So map of what do we need here? We need a map of character and integer. Why? And how did I decide upon this? Well, I want to map each letter to the number of times it appears. I want to say letter A 7 times, letter B 20 times, letter R 0 times, and so on. You know, of course, there will not be any letters that appear 0 times because we need to see it once in order to add it to the map. Of course, all the letters that are not there appear 0 times. So I'm just going to call this map or letter count, something like that. And I'm going to create a method called count letters that's going to do that for me. It will need to return a map, and that's basically it. Okay, so first of all, IntelliJ is smart. So if I say return result here, IntelliJ is supposed to be smart. Create field, create local variable. That's what I want. Thank you, IntelliJ. New hash map. And as we, to repeat one more time, a map is an interface, right? It's an interface that can, of course, it'll give you the size, tell you if it's empty, whether it contains a key, whether it contains a value. It has all the possible methods that you would expect from a map. You can get something using a key. You can put something using a key and a value. You can remove something and so on. You know, there's just a bunch of methods that every map must implement. Hash map is the unordered map. Basically, it will not order the keys in any particular order. Tree map will. Tree map is basically an ordered map. You know, it will order the results in the map by the key, you know. And we might also use that at some point. We'll see. Now, hash map will just do. So what do we need to do? Well, of course, a for loop for input.size. We need to, what? Dot length. I messed up. And we're going to say char letter equals input.charAt by. We take the letter. And what do we need to do now? Well, there's two possibilities. What is possibility number one? We already had that letter. And what's possibility number two? We are having this letter for the first time. So what do I ask? Well, I ask if result contains, you know, I start typing contains and there is contains key. We want to see which one of these do we want to use? Well, I want to see contains key because I want to see whether letter A was already added or not, because the key is the letter itself. The value is how many times we found it, right? I'm going to say contains key, and I'm going to say letter. Always false. Okay, IntelliJ is just trying to be smart because we didn't put anything in the map anywhere. It's like, hey, this is always false. Wait, IntelliJ, please, it's gonna be good. I always get scared when I see a warning. I'm like, well, what did I do wrong now? Okay. So if the result contains the key, we do one thing. What do we do? Can you guys try and guess? What do we do if we had already had A? Let's say for this second A, this is the case. So we already had A and it's already in the, you know, map. So what do I do when I find the second, third, fifth, and all the other A's after the first one? Maybe it's easier to first do the case where we didn't find the letter. So let's say this letter A comes in and we're like, okay, so what do I need to do here when the first occurrence of some letter comes in? Can you guys see this? It's very similar to what we've done with the array. Now it's slightly different. I need to put that in a map. Yes, that's, as Evan said, yeah, that's the answer for the case here, but I switched the question here. Yeah, add it to the map is what we need to do. And here we need to increase the value for that key. So you're both correct. Let's say result, and what do I put? I put my letter, and what's the value that I put here? It's an integer, so what number do I put here? So I found my letter A. It's letter A or letter K first time or letter S first time. So I'm saying letter S found how many times? Exactly. So I put one there because I just found it for the first time. This wasn't true. It wasn't contained in the map. Thus, I put it in a map and I say it's found once. Cool. What do I do here? I increase the value for that key. Let's see how we can do that. Well, first of all, we need to see the value. So let's say all value equals result.get key. What's the key? Letter. So I now say, okay, let's, I'll even improvise for you. I'll put a map here. Let's say A once, then K comes in, it's also there once, then S comes in, it's also there once, and I'm gonna put an A here just to don't have to search for it anymore. A comes in and I wanna put a two here, you know, and that's all I wanna do. I take the old value, which is gonna be one. I say result.put, what's the key? Of course, the letter that I'm currently looking at. Old value plus one. Whoops. And that's it, basically. I just return back, I just put back the value that I had plus one. This could have also been literally done in one line. This could have been here. Basically, instead of old value, I could have said result get, you know, but it's nicer like that. Yeah, it could have been a one-liner, but I just prefer to get some readability, you know. Okay. And that's basically it. This is the whole program. We just return that at the end, and finally we can just examine the results. And you can see, again, this simplifies lots of problems tremendously. And we'll see now in some more examples what we can do with this. So let's try this. Let's see this letter count. How do you display a map? Let me just see if I just put it here, letter count. I'm assuming it's gonna know how to present itself nicely as a string. Let's hope so. Okay, so letter A is there 7 times, letter Sh, which is a Serbian letter, is there 1 time, and so on and so on. Okay, cool. What would change if I put a tree map here? Can you guys try and guess? What's gonna be sorted? It's gonna sort, but what is gonna be sorted? Is it gonna go like A, B, C, or is it gonna go like 7, 6, 5, and so on? Yeah, it's gonna sort the letters in ASCII order. Why? Why is it not gonna sort the second thing? Well, because it sorts by the key. So let's just test that out. And number 3 is before A, apparently, as number 3. Number 3 viewed as a character comes before letter A. Okay, whatever. All the numbers apparently come before all the letters. We can even put some uppercase letters here as well to make sure that, you know, it's counting them as, you know, different from lowercase letters. But you can see A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and then U, V, W, Y, and then come the Serbian letters, which are after the English letters by ASCII code, you know. So yeah, sometimes you need a tree map. In this example, I would say a hash map would do. Let's go through it one more time. Basically, it's almost as if it's an array, but instead of putting something in an array, you would always put something like array of some number equals some value. You know, here, instead of the number, you can put anything. It can be a number, it can be a string, it can be a person. You know, it can literally be mapping, you know, a full class like main. This is, I mean, we have a class called main. It can map mains, so it can map anything. Anything here for arrays, we can only map an index to a value. Yeah, so this, you can imagine, it's a way more powerful array. It's costly, yes, because, you know, it uses some internal structures to store all this data and so on. So it's gonna, you know, be slightly, of course, slower and worse for performance than an array, but sometimes you just need that, and that's fine.